The history of my family, insofar as it concerns the present day, goes back to Stephen Moulton, my great-grandfather, who was an enterprising man, scientifically interested, and interested also in engineering, and he travelled after the Napoleonic Wars rather frequently to the United States. And on one of his visits, he became familiar with Charles Goodyear, who was this remarkable inventor of the vulcanizing of natural rubber to make that great change of rubber, which is to make an elastic material. And the United States at that time, and we're talking the 1830s, was not industrially developed. And he, Stephen Moulton, decided to return to England, on the one hand to find a seat for his family, and on the other hand to start to manufacture and exploit this remarkable invention for the burgeoning industry of the United Kingdom. And he came here to Brampton-on-Avon, probably because of a friend of his, Captain Pallaret, told him of the opportunities of a beautiful house, this one, the hall, running into ruin, which would be available for restoration, and on the other hand, the factory area, which was derived from the long-established woolen industry. At that time, again, they're talking of the early 19th century, the woolen industry was in decline, but there were, in addition to the factory premises, there were a workforce accustomed to factory operation. So it was this scene in 1848 that he, Stephen Moulton, established the India rubber, vulcanized India rubber industry in England, and at the same time spent 2 years restoring this house to the form which we see it today. Forward to one's own lifetime, 130, 40 years later, the childhood was spent here with my grandmother and to some extent my grandfather, though he died when I was 6, and it was a very happy period living on this place. And the factory, established 100 years before, was at that time still very much manufacturing engineering applications of rubber, and was, as it is to this day, at the bottom of the garden. Cited there, of course, by the original juxtaposition of the mill in relation to the River Avon. My interest in engineering was absolutely from childhood, and it may well have been that in living in the presence of a factory, on the one hand, living with the railway going across the river at the bottom of the garden, was an exciting thing for a child to be seeing. And also, although I had no parental, my father having died, no parental influence in engineering, I think it was true to say that I was helped a lot by a splendid estate carpenter called Cooper, who operated in one of the old mill buildings, doing all the work on the estate, a beautiful woodwork. And certainly he influenced me to the pleasure of fabricating and making things in out of the solid. As a boy, when I went to school at Marlborough College, I carried out struggled to make a steam car, which I was intrigued to try. And at Marlborough, I set up in the woodwork workshop my own lathe, which I used to bring back from here during the holidays so that I could work in the term time on parts, metal parts from my steam car. Then after Marlborough, I had applied to go to Cambridge for the qualifying exam for mechanical science TRIPOS, and between then Marlborough and Cambridge, I had an important in my life period at the Central Works in Shrewsbury, where I was a pupil, which is a paid apprentice, if you like, and learnt the craft, or something of the craft, of practical execution of engineering, which was of enormous value to me. Then a war came, and after a year and a bit of Cambridge, war came, and I applied for immediately on September, whatever it was, 6th, after recruiting for the Air Force, and was passed through the recruiting board at Cambridge and put down as a candidate for the engineering officer branch. But there was no vacancy until April 40. And I spent time at Bristol Aeroplane with, under the influence or under the opportunity given to me by Roy Fenton, who's the chief engineer and the godfather of a great school friend of mine. And that opportunity turned out the way it does under wartime in quite a strange way. We had in a very serious daylight raids on the Patchway Works at Bristol. It's even a book now written on it called the Raid on Filton. And it was a very serious amount of damage was done. And one of the project engineers, Adrian Squire, was amongst those killed. And on the next day, bell rang, and Roy Fedden, the chief engineer, said to me, "Moulton, you are to come and be my personal assistant to overlook the and help me with the work on the big Centaurus engine," which was the project which Adrian Squire had been in charge of, he having just been killed. So that altered one's life, and I had reserved occupation throughout the war, and I had an intensely interesting and intensely active time on Sir Roy Fedden's personal technical staff. And we young men were sent, as Peter Ware was also with me, we were sent on some extremely interesting missions. I mean, to see Sydney Cam, of the Hawker Hurricane, and Rex Pearson of the Vickers Company. And so we were used to Act 4, this great man, Roy Fedden, talking with other great and negotiating with other great engineers in the aircraft industry. So I was exposed to the influence of the highest quality of engineering at a very young age. After the war, my intention was to continue, or rather to join, the family firm, Spencer Moulton, which I did. And immediately on getting there, having learnt how a works operated and becoming an assistant to the works manager, I set about establishing the research department, which is here to this day, the building's here to this day, to study the further development of rubber suspension or rubber springing. And that, of course, led on to my work in, for which I'm probably best known in the sense of a significant contribution to innovative engineering, namely the vehicle suspensions. But that's perhaps another tale. But I had incidentally gone back to do my degree at Cambridge, and very valuable, I believe, in it to have an opportunity as a mature adult, I was in my late 20s, to do one's final education or final formal education, because you know at that time you know exactly what you want to learn and apply oneself very rigorously to it. Coming to the bicycle period, which is a thing that you're perhaps most interested in the late 50s, having established this Moulton Developments operation successfully by virtue of the association with BMC for car suspensions, I turned my attention to the bicycle itself, having the facilities to study and make prototypes and so on. And I think that it is true to say that, as I recall it, the 1956 Suez crisis coincided with a revival of the use of bicycles as a natural way of saving petrol. And I remember very clearly acquiring from an ex-Bristol aeroplane friend of mine, Jeff Warren, a very superb Hitchens handmade bicycle, and being delighted to find how good the riding on such a high-class, lightweight machine was. And remembering that one's previous bicycling experience was only that done at Cambridge, an undergraduate, where one used just an ordinary old clunker thing, as they call it nowadays, with no particular merit. So it was this renaissance, if you like, experience, or revival experience of cycling. As a mature engineer, I was therefore 35, and being cited by that, I said to myself, well, now I would really like to apply my efforts to making an improvement on the bicycle. And one of the first things that I did, because I'm very much a fundamentalist in my approach to engineering innovation, and one of the first things that I did was to question the fundamental of the attitude of the rider, the ergonomic attitude of the rider, to his machine. And I acquired, and we still got, I think, somewhere the fragments of the frame in lying around, an FH Grubb recumbent. Now, an FH Grubb made, probably from the French villa cycle origin, though it's more like one of the modern long wheelbase recumbents. Anyway, I got this machine, and there are some pictures around of riding this in order to establish whether or not the alternative position, which is the recumbent, was better or worse, in my view, to the conventional, the classical position, which really had come through from the Stalier of the 1890s. And I determined that the recumbent position was obviously potentially faster by the lower frontal area. But soon felt that, soon came the conclusion that on a ride, I think that I did to Bath, that the recumbent position was bad ergonomically for hill climbing. And I was also more concerned than anything with the difficulty of getting used to the control response, which I find to this day is a fact. So I made the decision that the conventional riding position was right. I had no particular quarrel about the components. I thought that over the years that the components were very sensibly developed, and that view I still hold. I mean, in latter years, of course, the extraordinary input of the Japanese, which should have been rightly belonging to the Western world, in my view, that if they'd shown sufficient enterprise. The Japanese work on components more than confirms my view that the components are adequately developed, but it was a fundamental flaw in the architecture of the conventional bicycle, or what I term classic, because it is so classically correct. I say classically correct because it came down so naturally and wonderfully by the Stalier in this great jump from the high wheeler or ordinary. And it fitted the whole construction technique and of the day, and still does, to more or less. But the architectural flaw that I saw and still perceive is that the arbitrary dimension of the wheel, at its reduction from the 50s and 60 inches to the 26 to 27 to 28 of the Stalier revolution, that it could be carried further down, and there was no fundamental reason why it shouldn't be smaller. Now, we know in the study of any wheel vehicle evolution, whether it's a locomotive, whether it's a car, automobile, or whatever, that with the one exception of the tractor, which has to go across soft ground and has traction across soft ground, the evolution of a wheeled vehicle has always been in the direction of reducing the size of the outside diameter of the wheel, and quite rightly so. The encumbrance of the large size is always, or the reduction of that encumbrance is always a sensible thing to do in the evolution of a design of vehicle. So I looked at how much smaller it could be made. And I had very good relations with the Dunlop company in Birmingham, at Fort Dunlop, due to the large business which my innovative designs in rubber suspension, the hydroelastic of that time, being made at incidentally very large quantities for the order of 12,000 cars sets a week in those powerful times of the late 50s, early 60s. So I had very good relations with Dunlop, and I set about with them, and they're an extremely competent technical team headed by Tommy French, set about a fundamental study of the relationship between the size of the wheel and the other parameters. And of course there was no good doing in a fundamental research of this sort, there's no good doing just taking a small tire and making a comparison with a large, because a small tire would probably be for some other use as a juvenile and wouldn't be comparable. So we made special tools or special molds and used the construction of the tire as was familiar with a large diameter, 27-inch diameter, high-class wired on, and we did the basic tests on rolling resistance, wear tests, and so on. And it soon became apparent that the fundamental fit, which is now, if you like, fundamentally obvious, that the parameter which was of the most significance in rolling resistance, which is the simplistic argument that in favor of large wheels, that the most significant factor in rolling resistance was the inflation pressure. So given a high inflation pressure, and given the quality of materials and the construction as used on the best large tire, then one could certainly go down in diameter significantly. And I certainly felt that 14 inches, or from our test, 14 inches might have been overstating it. 16 was entirely all right. 17 is the optimum. So that was the deep decision, backed up, or significant decision that I made, backed up by a deep set of proper measured results done in collaboration with Dunlop at Fort Dunlop. So that was the key, but it's no good having a small diameter wheel unless, and with high pressure tires, unless one had the benefit of wheel suspension. So right from the beginning, my bicycle, Moulton bicycles, always had wheel suspension. Now, wheel suspension was a common thing in the early part of the development of the bike, the sprung frame. And if you look at the history of the bicycles in that exciting period of the 1870s, 1880s, 1890s, there were many examples of sprung frame. Of course, the pneumatic tire, that brilliant invention, or perhaps enormously significant invention, the pneumatic tire, swept away the interest in the sprung frame. What I've done now, or when I say now, back in the late 50s, 60s, it was to combine the high pressure small diameter tire with wheel suspension, and that makes an advance in the total advance over the high pressure unsprung large wheel, an advance in road holding and in comfort, and that's perhaps the most significant thing that the Moulton bicycle has done. Same time, I was dissatisfied with the quadrilateral piece of piping, as I call it, of the classical bicycle's frame. I was dissatisfied with the top tube, which, as I've often said, if a bicycle was made, or a vehicle was made, introduced with that thoroughly unsafe feature today, it would probably not be allowed to be used. And so that the frame was mandatory, in my opinion, that the frame had to be open. And thereby became unisex, and thereby had a universal or nearly universal size of frame. So that was the thinking, which led to the form of the first Moulton bicycle, which carried through right across the 35 years, 30 years to today, where that thinking is entirely apparent and totally consistent. And all that I've really done, but from a design point of view, between those period, that early period to today, is to improve the efficiency of the manifestation of that idea. So here we are in our what I hope to be only a temporary museum. It certainly contains the collection of rather important examples of our early work. And I'm hoping in the future that there will be funds available for making a permanent collection in a better accommodation than we're in now. But meantime, let's look at the bikes. This one here is the Hetchins, the one that I've spoken about as being the introduction for me in 1956, I would think, to the joys of a lightweight bicycle. And it's amusing in a number of ways. It's a Hetchins Curly Stay, and it's amusing in a number of ways because it represents the artist craftsman with his highly embellished and figurative lug work. And that is a very natural thing for anyone who's working in a creative way, in a craft, that he or she naturally wants to embellish the work so that it is as beautiful as possible. And this makes a complete contrast to my work, where I've been concerned with the thing itself being functional, and I hope pleasing in appearance, but I would certainly not embellish it. Decoration is for another generation, perhaps, if anyone wants to embellish it in any way. My works, I hope, stand on their own functional merit, but still I'm hoping it'll be found visually pleasing. So that's the first bike, and representing the mature Starley in its rather lightweight racing form, the components which those of you who are conoscenti will recognize as up to date 30 years ago. The one thing that has changed, but there's the Brooks saddle. For my own oldish taste, I still find that is the nicest saddle, but I think contemporarily it could be said that it is has been replaced, perhaps prematurely, by plastic. Anyway, so much for that. So the first attempt was to make a small wheel bicycle with suspension, and all that we've got really left of it here is the monocoque aluminium structure. There are still photographs which show the complete bicycle running. And this is interesting because it shows in retrospect, and it was pretty quickly put into reality, a wrong judgment, though not stupid, on my part of making the new bicycle with a monocoque aircraft style structure. And you'll see that the very light gauge, in fact I think it's 24-25 gauge, Dural sheet, is riveted together. Now there's no welding, as in an aircraft even today, where the structure has to be of total integrity, a welded construction is used. And that's not an uninteresting as a lesson for the present. But one of the immediate results of riding this bicycle was to show the splendid merit of suspension when associated with a high pressure tire small wheel, but the resonating resonance which comes from road noise, which was such a terror on monocoque motor cars. And I said to myself, well, working as I do in automotive suspension, I'm not going to impose on future generation of cyclists the horror of road noise. So that was one reason. The other reason was that I went from it was to that it was apparent that the stiffening required for what in engineering terms is called the hard points, which is where the rear fork is, where of course the bottom bracket and transmission is, and where the head is, needs a lot of reinforcing because the loads are concentrated at those points. And therefore I very soon left this and went to the single big tube or F-frame, which I'll put that back, which can be sort of, I'll get it out if I can, sort of demonstrated in this one. I'll just see whether that
visible, one's got to immediately dissociate it with all that. Now that, just forget that if we can for a moment and look only at the big tube, the upright there, and a vestige of the enclosure which one had inherited from the earlier design. Now, let's deal immediately to, in order to dismiss it. This thing, as you see, is an adjustable head angle, like a slide there, and an adjustable trail. And very often in experimental work, one uses, in order to get something tested, one uses whatever is to hand. And we use this early original F-frame, Mark I as we call it, bicycle for that purpose. Therefore, it hasn't got suspension. That was used just for testing that. But mark the enormous difference between this big monotube open frame, still with the essentials of the wheel size, and believe it or not, it had a suspension there. We shall see it a little later. contrast that with a monocoque approach of a few months earlier. And this is really, this origin ran us right through. And we can have perhaps a look at this one. I'll put that back there. And have a look at, perhaps do I get this, perhaps I get this on. Now that was January 1960. And it contains the seeds of the new bike. And incidentally, a number of features which have come right through to the present day. A first attempt at an aerodynamic shield, of course the monotube, the big tube that I've spoken about before, the carrying, luggage carrying little bit there, and the pretty basket made on Sedgemoor, which is a feature of great attraction and style with the enclosure there, and a front and rear suspension. There it is, acting as sweetly today as 30 years ago. Front suspension, and I can show the rear suspension, there it goes. Central features are established January 1960. Then there was a period of offering this bicycle, the Vulcan bicycle, for manufacture under license by Raleigh, the world's largest manufacturer, and it brings back to mind very much the splendid support and interest that I received from George Wilson, who was the chairman of Raleigh, who came down here to Bradford to try these bicycles out. And I remember him saying it's the most interesting he'd seen in his long professional career. And then all the problems that we won't go into now of the not invented here syndrome with that big company, and the eventual manufacture on my own on the factory building, which one can see perhaps later opposite these sheds, which are the bicycle museum. this is the Mark IV prototype. Note how quickly, when one is on the right line, how quickly from January to May, from the Mark II to the Mark IV, the prototypes came out. And this is consequential upon sitting down with Raleigh at the time and giving way to some of the whims that were imposed in order to make it look more in the manner of the conventional bicycle. And this one here really is funny. The idea was that if it had an open frame, it had to be bent like a woman's bicycle. And so this idiotic thing of trying to bend this enormous tube was simply the imposition of a styling feature to satisfy the whim of the Raleigh people at the time. Didn't in any way come through into reality when I made my own machine on my own. So I put that away. Then as they go through, that was, as I said, a Mark IV, that was a Mark V, where there was a significant, perhaps that one can see it over here, the significant change of the flattened tube, the flat-sided oval, which came right through in all the first series of Open Bicycles. That was Mark V, June 1960. I want to emphasize the speed of our development under once we knew what we were doing. So that, I think, is the end of that. And we came into production, which we can see in this room over here. So in this room, we have a collection of the bikes which really were definitive to the actual first Moulton production bicycles, which this one in the middle here is a Moulton Deluxe, and that is the definitive design with all these nice features of stylistic features, if you like, of the billiard queuing to make the appearance of the long mast less apparent visually. That bicycle here was the bicycle actually used by that famous rider, John Woodburn, in his record-breaking ride from Cardiff to London in 62. And then there's another Deluxe bicycle, and a very, very special one here, a chromium pleated one, an all chromium one, an S Deluxe, which came out in 1964. So here, in a sweep of the eye, you can recognize the strong similarity of the first generation of Moulton bikes. And starting, in fact, from here, and if my eye actually does recognize that these are still prototypes, Mark VI, Mark VII, Mark VIII, which led up to this lot, all of which are specific to the first generation. So if this represents the a section version of the first generation bicycle, Moulton bicycle, in which you can see the features. Perhaps I can turn it the other way around. I see this is really rather awkward to see. if I can turn it like that, and you can see the front suspension, the neat telescopic thing up inside the head tube. You can see the forks looking very familiar familiar with a conventional bicycle. You can see that rather strange prop stand firing at the center of gravity, sort of spear, the conventional chain wheel or crank axle, and then the section at the end, the rear suspension down there. You can see the pivot, and you can see perhaps compression shear spring on the end of the flat-sided oval main beam. And so if that represents the first initial period where so many bicycles were made, and I'll just put this thing down if I may, is a collection of the evolution of the components of the Moulton bicycle from that first period right up through to the second period. And it is a rather unique collection of the evolution of components under the press of improving either their weight, reduction of weight, or their stiffness, or their fatigue life, or whatever may be the parameter of improvement that is the quintessence of good design. On the top row here, we have the rear triangle or rear fork, the sprung rear fork, and you can see these are before, in fact, the first series was definitive and jolly interesting. You can see the dichotomy of does one make, and I can lift that up perhaps, does one make, here's the pivot, there's the rear spindle, does one make the limbs, again in a monocoque thing, and that's not a silly way of doing it, they're two pressings, they're spot welded together. Or, does one, as one go forward, does one, that's a better way of doing it, or does one make it out of tubes? And that fascination of the bent tube will appear again and again in my design. So the tube is a very wonderful structural member, and the trick of the thing is to put it in such a fashion that it works efficiently. And if we just look around now, the whole row of the evolutionary processes up to the time that we got first into production, which is in fact, I've gone just overthrown it, V, there. That's the first production. And let me draw that a little bit nearer. You can see that it's painted, therefore it's not a prototype. And it comprises a highly manipulated tapered tube with a pressing pressed within, and that cup, that's a pivot obviously, that cup in there contains the compression shear rubber bonded spring, which is a rather elegant solution for it. That was the first production one. Then we go through and we see that there is appearing a modification, and let me go forward to that. And here we're giving way from my sort of aesthetically, if you like, preferred curved one of the first to the mid-60s structure requirements and strength requirements led one to straightening that out and boxing in the stiffening element of the back. That was an important feature. There was function giving way to what was perhaps overly leaning towards appearance of the first one. So that's an interesting point. Then we come further round again, and there we are in the late 60s, and taking the big step, which is actually one that's continued throughout, into a deeper triangulation. Recognizing that the tube was the way to do it, recognizing that the depth of the triangle is the most economical, and the spring, instead of being on the end of the backbone, appears, and if I can just point over there, to the apex, as you can see, to the apex of the triangle. And then if you just let your eye run round here, you can see triangulation after triangulation after triangulation, until we get to the ones which, if I may just come up to here, and that is the fully, more sophisticatedly triangulated, which is the birth of the new series, the AM series, where one was rising with the reduction of weight for a given stiffness and the use of more small tubes. And then they come right around here to the ones that are actually used. That painted one there is used in the new series bicycle, which we shall introduce to ourselves when we come through the frames. Now, let's look at the main frame. From the original one, of which an example you will have seen before, let us look at the drive to improve that. What are the thrust behind the drive? The thrust behind the drive are to make it lighter, to make it more convenient for a separation into two parts. And the whole array in the period of the 70s, when, one may recall, that the commercial operation with Raleigh had shut down, we'd separated, and I was still following the evolution of my idea of the improved bicycle system. And one of the things I wanted to do was really to get the best form of frame construction. And this is an array which shows the working of the, if you like, almost agonized working of looking in every direction. And we see the one which was not uninteresting, which was the Y frame. And that was taking the first series flat-sided oval. At the point, here is the point of separation for portability, and then we, as it were, take this material and spit it into a bifurcated thing, we call it an arrow, a Y thing, there and there, making a deep triangulation in the middle, and the seat post there. Not a bad thing. But still, not a bad solution at all, and I nearly went into production with this thing. But as I've often spoken, I was riding in France with a friend of mine, Philippe Carpentier, and he said, come and show your bicycle, I was this bicycle, to my French friend who's a racing cyclist, sporting cyclist, and he was very sniffy about the weight, and I said, right, well, I will not put it in production, but I will search again for a lighter solution. So these are, I'll put that down, and if one can care to look at, there are some aluminium constructions there that I looked at. There's even a wooden one, which was, of course, really a prototype for. I'll lift this up if I can get at it. This is quite interesting. This is a plywood construction, and not at all a bad way of doing it, which could, of course, really read on a composite. Nowadays one read on as a composite. This was actually an earlier study, it's a little bit out of sequence, but not a silly way of doing it at all. There's the bottom bracket, and there is the bonded compression shear spring there. And not a silly way of doing, but not really practical from a production point of view, without a very heavy investment in tools and a lot of manpower in labour in actually the layups. So let us come back to this line here, and you can see that one was really agonising about, can one get a single tube of large diameter with thin gauge, which is a conventional way of getting a stiff light structure. And you can see them coming on here mid-70s, on and on they go. And that wasn't a bad solution. Let me show you that one. That was the October 76. And that's not bad. But then, again, how does one comfortably do the split? Here's the point that you want to do the split. It's a difficult thing to gather up all those forces from a light tube and to separate them. And so I think that here is an October, November. Let me just get that out. There is an attempt at doing it. You can see that's where the slit is there. Here is the triangulation. And here you can get the problem of how do you get this large diameter, thin-walled element to join onto the head post. And you've got the problem of squashing it down there. A solution. Anyway, I didn't do any of those, and here is the jump change of recognizing in November 76, recognizing that the solution lies in the cruciform construction, in which fundamental different structural concept, in which the cruciform, meaning two beams, that beam and that beam, intersecting exactly, coincidentally, at the node or axis, and each of the beams being united there to there by a torsionally stiff member, there to there by a torsionally stiff member. This cruciform construction along that axis, the axis, as it were, of the tube which isn't there, it's an immensely stiff way, stiff in that direction, or indeed, obviously, if I could do that direction, it's immensely stiff. And this was the germ of the design which ran through and made the new series of bicycle, or the present AM series of bicycle. And I think all one need do is perhaps to sweep the eye across here. I should just put them around that right way, June 77, and then round about there. You can see there they go. There they go. There's the principle. We're using small tubes, our friendly small tubes, along in that way. So that's the birth of the frame structure of the new series, the leaving aside the original single tube, flat-sided oval, going by way of examining any alternatives to this space frame, dependent on that principle, which I'm happy that we are running forward with. So similarly, there's the evolution of the front suspension. That one, as the date implies, was the very first one, back in November 59, with compression rubber leading link. Then we tried some tension, and then the various triangulations, and you'll see the evolution to the one actually adopted. In that one is interesting. That has the toggle link suspension, toggle link guidance. which has appeared in a recent design, which was in the manner of, and then they gave the single telescopics through here, and that was an interesting one. That was our air suspension. We tried back in April 1970 an air suspension in comparison with the one that we continued with, and it's a very good point of lesson that many people today, and we're talking in 1990, are playing with air suspension, adiabatic sometimes called. We did that back in 1970, 20 years ago, and discarded it from a very basic reason that all these devices, which are telescopic and depend on seals as opposed to impermeable systems, always tend to leak, and that is why I think they're inappropriate for a bicycle. Different on the automotive thing where you may have a pump as in the Citroen cars. Then we come forward here into the 70s at the same time as I was talking earlier on the development of the frame. Here there's a more radical approach, and you'll see that you may recognize that one is using a rubber torsion springs, one is using leading links, one is using here beginning to get the leading link of the nearly definitive that we now use, and different types of stirrup design, and here we are in 81, very nearly there with the stirrup and the plunger to activate the coil spring with the height adjustment there. So this is the seeds of the present one, and I'm not dissatisfied in any way with where we are. It's a convenient, nice system with a spring coil spring housed up inside there, and with the damping polyurethane dampers down at the leading links. So that really is a parallel survey and array of the similar parallel work of evolution of the front suspension. So in this room we've got an assortment of complete bicycles, of which that's an interesting one. That's our first version of the Speed. You note that we always use a coding colour of white for our Speed bicycles with a big chain wheel. We hadn't developed the small sprocket at that time. That might have been the one that Tommy Simpson rode on test. That was this one here. It was an interesting track bike, one of very lightweight, with being a track bike, no suspension, therefore only specific for that purpose. And then a variety of them here, including, if I just get out of the way, including my personal Y-frame one that I used, which we've looked at the frame before, but that's my own personal bicycle. And incidentally, any bicycle which has no frame number on it that is not here has been stolen, because I have the practice that my bicycles only, personal bicycle only, have no frame number. So that is a nice little point. That is the nose cone of the first Moton Speed with an aerodynamic profile, that yellow object there, of great significance for aerodynamic resistance reduction, and which of course was the start of a great deal of work which goes on, and of which the first of the fairings on our present series is a practical production manifestation of it. Talking of Speed, this is a most valuable to me, and sentimentally valuable. This is the actual bicycle, the first of the Speed bicycles, AM Speed bicycles, ridden by that splendid man, Dave Bogdan, from Angle Lake, Seattle, on his second ride on the Ram. The Ram is a race across America, that appalling marathon, appalling in the sense of the stamina and determination of the riders. And he, Dave, rode this bicycle, the one of two, and this I think was the climbing one, and the other one, which had even larger chain wheels, was on the flat country one. And it has on here, from a sentimental point of view, very important, there's a lovely little message which was taped on, and it said, "Dave, we're with you, go." And that was that little message was from the support team, which included Doug Milliken and others from the Angle Lake Cyclery's support team, who were nine of them, and they provided that vital support for him on the 10 and a half days of that marathon across America. So this shows that our bicycle is capable of the longest endurance ride, and was chosen by Dave Bogdan for the second time running because of his preference for it, especially by virtue of the suspension, which gave front and rear, which gave the isolation of vibration. You can see the rear one there, is the curtain spring there, isolation from vibration, which was so important on that tremendous ride. So this is a very treasured possession in our museum. And Dave, if you watch this, thanks for it all. Now, this is the original factory, put up, as you'll see, in 1963, and extended. The main part of the thing was extended very soon after that, and this office, in fact, was added in 1969. And this was a custom-built factory that I did on my ground in response to the very big demand which came out of the 62 Earls Court show. And in this factory we've made something like 25,000 bicycles, and so it is very much part of the history of the Moulton enterprise. In latter years it was Moulton Developments, where our car suspensions were done, and I'm very happy that the Rover Metro, coming out in May 1990, has my hydrogas suspension on it, and currently this building now belongs to Anthony Best and his firm, Anthony Best Dynamics. Anthony Best was my principal assistant when I was working there, and he joined me back in the late 60s, so that's his business now, but it's satisfying that there's a continuity across the generations, working in the field that was my original work of vehicle suspensions. That's just from an historic point of view. Have a peep at this thing, which is now no longer used, but it is the track, bicycle track. Just with, may I just point to this? This is the curved track that I put down when we built this factory in 63, in order that bicycles could be tested by riding round. And of course it's quite historic. And it's an amusing thing that when the Ordnance Survey were doing a re-survey of this area for that map, I was just checking it and I said, why have you put this path round square? Go and look at it. It is a nicely banked track, because it was built as a test track for bicycles. That historically will be interesting, so they altered it. But you can see the track then. We had some very, very exciting racing around it, which was all part of the game of identifying the manufacturer of the bicycle with the thing itself and with its product. When we look round at this range of bicycles that have been produced over the years, one may wonder how these things start. And I can tell you, they start in the mind. There's no other way of describing it but to say that they come from an individual's mind. We're not talking about a consensus, we're talking about an individual and how he regards the object which he wants to create. Now, the word create has the connotation is correct. He wants to make something better. And it is the striving for improvement that's driven me along and still drives me in connection with the bicycle. But it starts in the mind. Now, the mind, with its amazing flexibility of concept, must, in an engineering artifact, we're not talking about the poetry or not talking about the composition of music, but an engineering artifact, it must be brought into a frame of reality. Now, the first thing that one does under the drive of bringing this concept or idea into reality is to make some sketches. And there's nothing better than a pencil or a pen. I use these rather nice hard pens and produce sketches, which of which you may be able to see that. That's how what I'm looking at there is in connection with an aerodynamic aid, which you've seen some examples in the museum. I'm seeing how the relevant factor of the thing, which is the sweep of the handlebar, relates to that. And then that in turn demands some movement of the brake levers, and therefore one sees the alteration, sketching out the alteration of an alternative position. So sketching is the first step in the move from the mind to reality. Now, again, we're dealing with a hard discipline in engineering, and it's no good having nice sketches. They must be constrained by the laws of nature. Now, if one is examining a new thing, as opposed to merely repeating with that which has received wisdom has ordained, one must make calculations. And the way, I mean, again, I very much believe in the fundamental and basic approach, and that is why, for calculation, there's nothing better than a pocket calculator, particularly of these scientific types, which can actually print out a function, which one uses in that way, that does not require programming. And a calculation might look like, and let me just show you this. I'll turn it upside down, but it doesn't matter. I mean, it is simply an iterative, if you like, or a series of equations which have been solved in order to examine a particular function. So that is is to check with some conclusions, which you may just see or indicate at the end, as what to do. Now, when the idea has been sketched out and has been seen to be feasible from a theoretical point of view, in other words, within the laws of engineering laws, then an orderly drawing must be made. Now, this can either be done by making it specifically, and I now just move over to the drawing board to show you what that looks like. And moving over here, we come to a small drawing board, which is this little one here. And it's important to say that, and I think that I'm in common with most engineers of the past, that one is fortunate in having draftsmen who are acquainted with one's method of thinking, and therefore it is communicating to a draftsman, which is very often the way that one proceeds, in other words, from the sketch and talking with the draftsman, looking over his shoulder, or in the case of things that are able to be got onto this small size board, I do sometimes the first step of drawing myself in the usual familiar way. As regards CAD, I think that is, although very much, and now I could go back and talk about that, very much in vogue, I strongly believe in nothing between the mind, the eye, other than the pencil, and communicating straight onto paper. If you go by way of CAD, then that is another something that's in between the eye and the hand. So that, if you like, is the method of the creating, and all the the designs and artifacts that we've had a look at have had their origin in this sort of way. Now, in engineering, as opposed to any of the other creative arts, except I suppose the theatre, where at least you get nowhere without the company playing, or the architect, where the design is nothing until the thing is built. In engineering, one certainly has to have a number of people for the interpretation of the hardware. And looking back over the years, and this very splendid and delightful and most pleasing to me, lovely picture by Brian Walker,
given to me, to my great surprise and pleasure, on my 70th birthday. And on the back, and I could read off a few names, on the back, over the years, brings to mind that I've been fortunate in having working with me as assistants. Let me go back. Phil Unkles, a splendid man, with which I always call the man with real green fingers. And he was with me for many years until he had an unfortunate motor accident and is no longer able to help me. And then of today, I've got Tim Bigwood, who's been with me now since, he's now must be his mid-40s or early 40s, and been with me since he was left school. And you need somebody at your hand to take the first steps into reality, to do the tests. Now, testing is that other aspect of engineering creation which is absolutely of paramount importance. And test results, or testing, guide the judgment that one may have made. And here, for instance, are some test results which are graphed out. And there are many others. I've got stacks of them around. But testing is the check between the prognostication and the reality, and one must always bow to the reality of what is actually measured. And so one needs, always needs, a very small, and often the smaller the better, team to help one. I've got in another name that jumps to mind is Brian Cottrell, who came to me in the late 50s and certainly did the drawing for me of the first generation of bicycles, and I'm delighted to say that he's still with me now on a part-time basis and able to execute the drawings of which. Here is an example of a current, in fact a new bicycle which I can show you a glance at, which is a quarter scale of his drawing which has been going on now down in the drawing office with myself leaning over his shoulder and telling him how I wanted everything interpreted. So that, if you like, is just a few words about the actual act of engineering creation or creativity. And in summary, what am I being driven by? I've been driven by wanting to improve, to understand deeply and to improve that artifact or device which interests me. And that very much included the bicycle. And I hope as long as I'm alive to be able to continue to do that. And after I've gone, my splendid assistants who are still around me will be able to carry on the work and keep the continuity of the Molten in the manner that I have ordained it or directed it going into the future.